So the course outcome for this chapter especially is after the chapter you will understand and will be able to evaluate the problem related to the single phase force and free convection heat transfer. You will see what we mean from force and free convection. However, they are already introduced to you briefly. The lesson outcome for this session is I will explain the concept of boundary layer this term, and also some fundamental equations involved or related mainly to these boundary layers. So this is what we are going to see in today's session. Okay, what is the physical mechanism of convection? If you remember, when I introduced you convection, I told you we need to have a fluid in contact with a surface of solid or liquid body, exactly. And that fluid should be in motion. So this is the requirement to have convection heat transfer. This is also highlighted here. In both cases, for conduction and convection, we need to have a material medium. You know, for radiation, we don't need to have material medium, but for conduction and convection, we need to have the material medium. The main difference between convection and conduction is the fluid motion, which we need for convection transfer. This is important, and you need to check first when you are going to calculate to consider the heat transfer for a heat transfer problem. You need to understand which type of heat transfer do you have. If you have material medium, and also that material medium, one of that is fluid and it is in motion, you may have convection heat transfer. And this is also important, you know, later you will see why it is important. In real world, actually, a real application is important. The rate of heat transfer through a fluid is much higher by convection than induction, okay? So if you are going to cool down something, if you are going to use heat transfer science to reduce temperature of the medium, for example, to cool down the electrical component in a PC or in the laptop, you can, you know, without fan, also you can have conduction, you know, from the body of the laptop, heat which is generated in the CPU and electrical component of the laptop will be transferred to the surrounding, for example, to the table. But you can, you already know about that, we have a fan inside the laptop. That fan actually provide the convection transfer. And the reason for application of that fan exactly in the laptop is to provide a convection heat transfer, the force convection heat transfer. Then the heat transfer, heat will be transferred from laptop to the surrounding with higher rate. And also, as much as the velocity of this fluid which is in motion is higher, the rate of heat transfer by convection also will be higher. This is also important. So we are interested to use force convection heat transfer, to use a fan like what you can see here. Then the reason for this is to increase the velocity of the fluid like earlier. Then the rate of heat transfer by convection also will be increased. So if you notice here also, it is shown the different type of the heat transfer. When, you know, let me start with the conduction. When we have fluid like air in contact with the surface, but no motion in the fluid, which is air here, then the heat transfer from this hot surface to the air is only by conduction. So we have only conduction. If the heat from this surface is transferred to the air, And this air is in motion, but naturally in motion due to the difference between the density of the cold and hot air, then it will be called natural convection. So here we don't have any fan, anything to force the air to flow or blow the air. But if we have a device or equipment like what you can see here, a fan, then we circulate the air above this surface. In this case, because we use an external component to increase the velocity of the flow, then we call that forced convection. You see three different types of the heat transfer modes, actually, conduction and two modes of the convection, and you can see difference. This is very important because if you cannot distinguish which type of heat transfer you have, then you cannot calculate correctly the heat transfer rate, temperature of the body, and so on. Convection, as I said before, you can see here we have fluid. So the convection transfer is strongly depends on fluid property. The property like dynamic viscosity, thermal conductivity, density, specific heat, and fluid velocity. It is supposed you already know about this, you know, properties in from fluid dynamics. However, we will review some of them, how we can calculate them. Thermal conductivity is already introduced to you. Density is the basic, you know about that. The specific heat also introduced to you. About fluid velocity, excuse me, near the surface and also far from the surface, we will discuss in this session, and also about dynamic viscosity. Moreover, you know, these properties are for the fluid. So the convection transfer mainly is dependent on these properties which are related to the fluid. And also the convection is dependent on the body, you know, the surface which the fluid is in contact with that. The properties of the important property of that body are geometry of that body. It should be mentioned which what is the geometry of the body which is in contact with this fluid in motion. It is a plate, a surface, it is curved, it is you know, the shape, the geometry is important. And also the roughness of the surface. Roughness of the surface is a property which you already know about that. However, I will highlight that in this session, how it is effective. Roughness is not directly effective on the convection heat transfer. It will change the property of the fluid, you know, then it will change the convection heat transfer. Furthermore, the type of fluid flow also is important. I will introduce you different type of fluid flow. However, you may know about that already from fluid dynamics, like streamlined and turbulent fluid flow. And the type of fluid flow also is effective on the rate of heat transfer by convection. We will go to all of these definitions, and we will see the effect of each one of these parameters on the convection heat transfer. About the equations which we use in these mode of heat transfer, if you remember, we had this equation for convection heat transfer. Should that by convection or rate of heat transfer by convection is equal to H AS TS minus T infinity. H is the convection heat transfer coefficient. It is properties of the, you know, fluid actually, or the properties of the related to that specific time of the heat transfer. I mean, you know, it is different from thermal conductivity. Thermal conductivity is a property for body. AS is the surface heat transfer surface area. For example, that you know, this solid, the surface area. The surface area normal to the heat transfer direction. TS is temperature of the surface. This surface. This is the surface of the transfer. And T infinity is temperature of the fluid. Enough far from the, or sufficiently far from the surface. What we mean from sufficiently far from the surface, station also we will introduce that. However, I already told you that we mean sufficiently far from the surface when the temperature here is will develop, the temperature vector actually. In other words, if we start from here, temperature here is 50 degrees Celsius, then temperature in different distance from the surface will be different until we reach a temperature which is same as temperature of the surrounding, and the temperature of the surface is not affecting on that temperature, that the point of the fluid. We call that sufficiently far from the surface. So this is the basic equation. You know already about that. The unit is, as usual, for rate of heat transfer is what? But as I told you, the convection heat transfer is mainly dependent on the fluid properties and also the fluid and surface interaction. Based on this interaction, we may have some interesting behavior for the fluid, like no sleep condition. When a fluid is flowing over a body, a solid or even liquid, then the velocity, you know, the velocity of the flow in different distance from the surface will be different. For example, near the surface, as you can see here as well, we have no slip condition. In this point, the fluid is in contact with the surface. So we assume, or actually it should be, the velocity of the flow should be same as the velocity of the surface. How much is the velocity of the surface? It is zero. So we can say that the fluid sticks to the surface due to the viscous effect, and there is no the velocity here near the surface is zero. We call this no slip condition. The rest of the these you know counter of the flow velocity, we call that boundary layer, but not all of these counters is boundary layer. The flow region adjacent to the wall in which the viscous effect and thus the velocity gradients are significant. Here, you know, the velocity is zero for the fluid. And after that, until some distance from the surface, the velocity of the fluid is still under effect of the surface. You can see here, you know, the velocity of the fluid, for example, A here, before it reaches to the solid surface will be like for all layers we have same velocity or we have uniform velocity, but when it reaches to the surface, near the surface, we have no slip condition, zero surface, zero velocity for the fluid. And the effect of this you know surface and the fluid contact will continue until distance, as you can see here, until here, for example, still the velocity of the flow is under effect of the surface contact or the friction between surface actually and the fluid. So here we call this boundary layer. We will discuss about that later more. This boundary layer is also dependent on the viscosity. Also, the no slip condition, both of them are dependent on the viscosity of the fluid. Viscosity is a property for fluid. So it is not for solid, it is property of the fluid. So if the viscosity of the fluid is higher, the movement of the flow over the body will be harder. And this will cause the larger or longer boundary layer for the flow. This is the illustration and a real photo actually of the velocity profile. As you can see here, how is the near the surface, you can see. And this is the illustration of the how flow is the flow velocity, fluid velocity over a surface will change. When this information enables us to come out with some equations to calculate the heat transfer, especially on those boundary layers. If you remember, similarly for the conduction heat transfer, we had some differential equation. We used the boundary layer to calculate the heat transfer by conduction. Here, we will also start with the most simple type of the convection, and we will use the boundary layer which we have, or boundary condition. Based on what I told you, when we near the surface, in contact with the surface, the velocity of the air, of the fluid will be zero. It means near the surface, what we have actually is not convection, it is conduction, because the fluid here, fluid near the surface is stick to the surface, so the fluid here almost is not in motion, and we can say that we have only conduction. So the rate of heat transfer by convection close to the surface is equal to the rate of heat transfer by conduction from the surface to the fluid, or from fluid to the surface for that that specific layer close to the surface. And if you remember, we had this equation, the Fourier law. If you remember, negative K, the partial of temperature with respect to when y is equal to zero. What we mean from y is in this direction. When y is equal to zero, it means on the surface, then heat transfer from the surface to the fluid on this surface will be like, instead of convection, we will have conduction. However, it will help us to develop an equation for the convection in other layers. So for conduction, you know about this equation. K is the thermal conductivity of fluid because the heat is transferred from surface of solid. And you know about the solid or the substance that the surface doesn't have any heat transfer through that. Only from that we have heat transfer. So heat is transferred from the surface to that layer near the surface, when y is equal to zero. So by this combination, we can come out with an equation. If you remember, for the convection, we have this is general equation, Newton's law. If now, instead of Q dot by convection, if we substitute that equation, the Newton's law, instead of this, then if we rearrange this equation, we can calculate H. You can see here that boundary that when the heat transfer from convection is converted to the conduction, actually, or no slip condition, will help us to calculate these H. You know, for thermal conductivity is a property of substance, you know, it is almost constant, we can calculate that. But H is dependent on the solid, you know, you can see here, H depends on which parameters. It is dependent on the thermal conductivity of fluid, the, you know, the differential of the temperature with respect to Y in this direction, actually, and also the temperature difference between surface and the temperature of the fluid sufficiently far from the surface. So by this, we can calculate this convection heat transfer equation. And if you notice here, we can have all of this information to calculate H, which is convection heat transfer coefficient. And for your information, usually in for convection heat transfer, the question is not about rate of heat transfer. Usually, and you will see, we are looking for H, because this H is unknown and it depends on the geometry, the fluid property, and also the surface property and many other parameters. So H is a complicated parameter to be calculated. So usually the question is about the H. And this H actually also will be more complicated when you consider X direction. You know, in this direction, when the fluid reaches you know, the surface of the body, initially, it is like this, uniform velocity. As long as this flow is, you know, move from the surface, it will, you know, go more distance on this surface. You know, this counter, this velocity, this relative velocity will be different. So for each x, actually, we have, you know, for example, initially, their form will be, for example, like this, you know. Then like this, more developed, you know. And like this. So this, you know, this velocity, the relative velocity of fluid layers will be different in each X. So it will become more complex. Then, in that case, to calculate the H or to use H, we usually use average H, which is H value over the entire surface area or length, which is or L of the surface. I'll be from here to here, for example, L, or the surface area. As the surface area, then H, the average, you know, if we want to know exact H for each X, we need to solve, you know, this equation for each X. It will be too complicated. But instead of that, because usually we are not interested about just the transfer in one point, instead of that, what is more important for us is heat transfer from whole surface. So to find H, an average H for whole surface, we can use these two equations. This is the average H value for surface AS, 1 divided by AS, integration of H local dA. So if we calculate H here for just y equal to 0 and in 1x, then we can develop that for whole surface. Or we can calculate h using L or the distance. H equal to y divided by L integration of hx dx from when the L is changed from 0 to n. So the integration is in whole length of the surface. We have these two equations to calculate the convection heat transfer coefficient for the surface or average convection heat transfer. The other property which is very important, and you will see, you know, you will have questions, for example, just to calculate this Nusselt number. Why this number is important? If you remember, we have different number for fluids. You know, the behavior of the fluid is much more complicated compared to the solid. The form of the solid, the geometry of solid, almost remain constant during most of the transfer processes. We don't have motion for the solid and so on. But for the fluid, we have motion in the fluid, and we usually need to have more complicated equations and also some constants, some numbers to be able to predict the behavior of the fluid. Nusselt number is also developed for this purpose. We use this number to show how the convection heat transfer from the surface is happened or how much is effective convection heat transfer from a surface. And we this number actually is the Nusselt number, or we show like this in U or no, by it is calculated using comparison between the convection heat transfer and conduction heat transfer. In other words, the rate of heat transfer by convection divided by rate of heat transfer by conduction is equal to the Nusselt number. So one way to describe the convection heat transfer, how much it is effective for heat transfer, is to compare convection heat transfer with conduction heat transfer. In previous slide also you have seen, when we don't have any convection heat transfer, but we have fluid and we have the, you know, the other body, solid or liquid, then we can have that pure conduction, force, and natural convection. So, in worst case, when we don't have convection, we have conduction. And if we have convection, then rate of heat transfer will increase by this extra rate of heat transfer by convection. Then, when we have, you know, in heat transfer at the boundary surface within a fluid, this Nusselt number is the ratio of convective to conductive heat transfer across or normal to the boundary. It is also dimensionless, so it is a number without any dimensions, and it will determine the you know, the relation between the convection and conduction. To calculate that, it is easy. You know, the concept, however, the Nusselt number calculation also is complicated. Simply, as I told you, Q dot by convection, rate of heat transfer by convection divided by Q dot by conduction will give us this Nusselt number. You know about the Q dot by convection, H delta T. If you remember, delta T means TS minus infinity and so on. But because here, both of the convection and conduction are between these two temperatures, T of the surface and TS, we can write like this. Convection, rate of convection transfer, H delta T, divided by rate of conduction transfer, K delta T, divided by L. Cancel. So we structure this equation, we will have H L K. H is the property of the fluid, K also is property of the fluid, is thermal conductivity, this is convection coefficient, coefficient of convection transfer, and this will give us the Nusselt number. or nu equal to h. Now instead of L, we have LC. LC is the characteristic length. You know, L means this distance, as I told you before. Okay. When we have a plane surface, like you can see here, L is simple. We know how much is there. But sometimes the surface is a curve. The surface may have, you know, different structure, different geometry. Then to put L in this equation, we need to find LC or characteristic length. We will have, we have tables for different geometry to find LC for different geometry. You will see later. So L is the LC is the characteristic length. And I think you have already understood that the larger Nusselt numbers means more effective convection. So we are interested when we are going to use especially convection transfer to increase these Nusselt numbers. And this Nusselt number can be used to compare different convection heat transfer. Higher Nusselt number means higher convection heat transfer. And you can see also, you can also compare, use the Nusselt number to compare convection and conduction. And when Nusselt number is equal to 1, what it means? If we go back to our equation, Q dot by convection divided by Q dot by conduction, if it is equal to 1, it means Q dot by convection or rate of heat transfer by convection is equal to rate of heat transfer by conduction. This is, this will one way to know the test heat transfer which we have. If Nusselt number is equal to 1, you know, it means we have only conduction. And it is also mentioned here. The concept, I think, also is clear for you why we have this property. Because, you know, usually this happens near the surface when we don't have motion for the solid with respect to the for the fluid with respect to the surface. Then the induction and convection will be identical and the Nusselt number will be equal to 1. As you can, as you have seen here, we are interested to have higher Nusselt number or higher convection heat transfer usually. In this slide, we have some examples of that. In the figure, you can see also when we are going to cool down our food, we blew that. And actually, we are increasing the convection heat transfer, or we use forced convection heat transfer. We force the flow of the fluid over this body. Or we use fan in our houses. This will also increase the convection heat transfer by increasing the velocity of the fluid or the air. You will see later how the velocity is effective on the Nusselt number and the convection transfer. Or to steer the soap or to blow to hot slide with other type of the convection heat transfer. Or you may feel in windy days that the temperature is, you know, you feel the weather, the temperature is lower and it is colder. And also the simplest solution to cool down the electronic packaging like our laptops is to use a fan, enough large fans to cool down the or to reduce temperature of the electronic components or package. So this is some real application of the convection heat transfer, and the rate of the convection heat transfer is much higher than inductive transfer based on the property of the fluid and also the surface, and you will see later how much it can be effective to reduce or increase the temperature of the different media. Before that, before we go directly to the convection heat transfer calculation, more definition about the convection heat transfer. As I told you, the convection heat transfer is highly dependent on the fluid property. So let's talk about the fluid. The information which I share here may be, you know, familiar for you. Most of them are same as what you have already learned in the fluid dynamics, especially fluid dynamics too. So we will just review them here in this chapter for you to recall those information. First of all, we have different classification of fluids. One of them is, you know, the fluid near the surface is viscous or inviscid. Based, you know, the viscosity of the fluid will cause, you know, viscosity is the resistance of the fluid against motion. This is the definition of the viscosity. When we are going to move a fluid like honey is a good example, it will resist against this motion. We call that resistance to the motion as viscosity. I'm not going to define viscosity here again for you. You need to know that from fluid dynamics. But here, one type of classification is viscous versus inviscid regions of flow action. The viscous flow is near the surface, like what you can see here, flow in which the frictional effects are significant. You can see here, this is the flow, and near the surface, you can see the shape, the contour, the velocity of the flow is changed due to the friction between the flow and surface. This region, this region is called viscous flow, or the flow which we have here is called viscous flow. But this region, above this, or the, beyond this region in both sides, this is in both sides, if we have flow both sides of a plate, for example, beyond that region, we have inviscid flow region. In this region, the friction between the surface and fluid is not that much effective on the property or the, mainly the velocity of the fluid. So in many flows of practical interest, there are regions usually far from the solid surface, like what you can see here, where viscous forces are negligibly small. Here, the friction will change the fluid, but here is not effective. The viscosity, the friction, and the fluid property. So this region is called viscid flow region. This region is called viscous flow. The other classification with the, for the fluid flow is internal and external. Based on the flow which is inside something, okay, or outside something, we have internal and external flow. I think it's easy to understand. The flow of an unbounded fluid over a surface such as plate or wire or pipe. You know, the fluid is around something is external flow. When we have fluid flow inside something like the flow in a pipe or duct, if the fluid is completely bounded by solid surfaces, we call we say actually we have internal flow. These will, you know, after these next sessions, you will see these will cause also to have external convection transfer and also internal convection transfer. So this is the other classification for fluid flow. This is related to the fluid, not only for the heat transfer action. An interesting example also is the flow of liquid in a duct. If you notice in a duct, we have open channel flow because usually one surface of that duct is the duct is open. If I can draw something for you here, the duct is usually something like this. Okay, then you can see we don't have this surface, so it is not internal flow. Actually, we can say it is internal flow, but it is a special case. It's a special case of the internal flow. We call that open channel flow. It is only partially filled with liquid and there is a free surface. So if we have liquid or fluid inside, and this is an example of external flow. We have this is a tennis ball, and the flow is over the surface of the ball. We call that external flow. The other classification is compressible versus incompressible flow. Simply, if the fluid is compressible, we call that compressible flow. If it is not compressible, we call that incompressible flow. But the velocity of the flow is effective on this definition. In other words, based on the velocity of the fluid, we will determine if it is compressible or incompressible. Incompressible flow is the density of the flowing fluid remains constant, like liquid. So for liquid flow, usually we have incompressible. Compressible flow, usually we have for gases, the density of fluid changes during flow, like high speed gas flow. And as I said, this speed is effective on to determine if it is compressible fluid flow or not. When analyzing especially the rocket, the spacecraft, and other systems, which the velocity of them is too high, we have high speed gas flow, you know, from those rockets, from those spacecrafts, or around, you know, those rockets or those missiles even. Then we can define the flow speed by a number, which we call that Mach number. Mach number is calculated by comparison between the velocity of the flow and velocity of the zone. So Mach number is equal to the speed of the flow divided by the speed of the zone. The speed of the zone, as you know, is 346 meters per second, but at room temperature and sea level. This if the level the elevation is different, and also if the temperature is different, the velocity of the air will be also different. But the standard for that at room temperature, sea level, the velocity or the speed of the stone is 346 meters per second. And this is a hint for us. Gas flow can often be approximated as incompressible if the density changes are under about 5%, okay? So if the fluid flow, as I told you, the speed of the fluid is effective on the density. And for liquid, it is not that much effective, and we usually have incompressible. But for the gases, this fluid flow if we need to compare, we need to calculate the Mach number. If Mach number which is less than 0.3, then the density of the fluid during that flow, it can only change by 5%. In that case, we can say that we have an incompressible flow even for the gases. So for the liquid is easy, usually we have incompressible flow, but for the gases or even for the liquid, we need to check Mach number in highest. Okay, so if the speed is 0.3 Mach or 103.8 meter per second, if the velocity of the flow is less than this, we can say that we have incompressible fluid flow. So this is also important to check if you have incompressible or compressible flow. You can check by Mach number or by or using the fluid speed. I hope it is clear. The other classification for fluid flow is the laminar versus turbulent flow. The laminar fluid flow is like this. You can see here, you know, this is a fluid flow. You can see different layers. You know, usually the fluid is flowing in layers. And you can see here that we have an ordered layer or parallel layer of the fluid flowing together. And you can see here they are well ordered. In this case, we have laminar fluid flow. You know, is laminar fluid flow. When the highly ordered fluid motion characterized by a smooth layer of fluid, like what you can see here. When we have this kind of the fluid flow, usually we have these fluid flow for high viscosity fluids such as oils, especially at low velocity. So when in most of for most of the fluid, when the velocity is low, we have laminar fluid flow. And later you will see also we define Reynolds number, and by that we will determine the if a fluid flow is laminar or turbulent. But generally, lower speed we have laminar fluid flow. In higher fluid velocity of the fluid flow, we usually have something like this. You know, the layer are not smooth, not parallel. Then they are disordered. The highly disordered fluid motion that typically occurs at high velocity and is characterized by velocity fluctuation. Right, you can see here. We call this turbulent fluid flow. The flow of low viscosity fluid, like air, for example, in high velocity, you typically turbulent. So this is just general. As I said, we need to calculate Reynolds number, then we can determine if it is laminar or turbulent. But this is definition, smooth layer, lower velocity, which occurs in lower velocity for high viscous fluid is laminar, but for low viscous fluids and in higher speed or velocity, especially, we have turbulence. When the speed is in the range which the fluid flow is changing from the laminar to the turbulent, we have transitional fluid flow, like what you can see here. Here we have, you know, laminar. Here we are going toward turbulent fluid flow. You know, you can compare here. This region is not like this, not this much disorder, but it is not also like this, a smooth layer. So we call it transitional fluid flow. The other classification for different flow is natural or unforced versus forced flow. I think it is clear. If we use any external equipment to change the velocity of the fluid in motion, we call that forced flow. The fluid is forced to flow over a surface or in a pipe by external medium such as a pump or fan. We call that fluid flow as the force. And when we don't use any equipment like what I mentioned here, we say that we have natural flow. But why natural flow occurred? We have natural flow here. Natural flow here is due to the difference between temperature in different layer of that fluid, which will cause different density for that fluid. So in that case, you know that due to the gravity, the cold, air, which is in density is higher, will go downward, and the density of the air, for example, with higher temperature will be lower, and it will go to upward. And we have a rotation between the cold and hot air, actually, or the fluid. So we call that the and this is the reason why we have natural flow. Fluid motion is due to the natural, which the rise of warmer or lighter fluid and the fall of cooler or denser fluid. You can see an example here. These shadows which you can see here is the natural motion of the air surrounding our body. The body of this person. As you can see here, we have this motion of the air. The other classification is a steady versus unsteady flow. I think these terms you already know about that. The steady implies no change at the point with time. Okay, so nothing changed for that flow with time. After 10 minutes, for example, the velocity is still 10 meters per second, for example. But if the velocity is changed with time or with the location, we don't have a steady flow. And the term uniform, also, which we use usually for a steady flow, implies no change with location or a specified region. This is also a difference between steady and uniform. Steady means no change at the point with time. Uniform, no change with location. Usually, the flow which we need to calculate the Carnot-Chain transfer for them, we assume that they are steady and uniform flow. So this is two important definition as well, which you can check or you need to assume before you start to solve a problem. And why this is important? Because in real world, most of the equipment, devices, which we have convection heat transfer for them, or we have a fluid flow in them or surrounding them, can be considered as a steady flow devices, like turbines, compressors, boilers, condensers, heat exchangers. You know, all of these equipments are important equipment in our daily life. So if we can have an assumption to make the calculation less complex for this equipment, will be a big help for us, which one of that assumption is we have a steady flow. Later you will see how much it is important. And why they are a steady flow? Because for a long period of time, under the same condition, if we don't change anything, they are also classified as a steady flow devices. Nothing changed for them with time as well. So usually for these devices, we can assume that we have a steady flow. The other classification for the fluid flow is about the dimensions of the fluid flow. if we have one dimensional, two dimensional, three dimensional. If you remember in conduction heat transfer, we have already discussed about that, which we may have one, two, and three dimensional heat transfer. Similarly for the fluid flow. But here, what we need to consider to determine if we have one or two or three dimensional heat transfer is the velocity. If the velocity of the fluid flow is significant in all of the direction, 3D, then we say we have two-dimensional flow. But usually we don't have something like this. Usually we have one-dimensional transfer, like channel, which you can see here. The velocity, this is uniform velocity, and you can see here it is changed, but it is only dependent on the R. Imagine this is a tube or a pipe, then the velocity, the counter is only dependent on R. So we have one-dimensional fluid flow here. No, there isn't any fluid flow in this direction, and we have only in this direction, which can be considered as one-dimensional heat transfer, one-dimensional fluid flow action. The other important, we have finished, we have done the classification of different flow. Now let's see how is the velocity of the fluid flow in different, location of the fluid when it is flowing over a surface. To do that, to calculate the velocity, especially of the fluid flow near the surface, we need to define velocity boundary layer. What is velocity boundary layer? The region of the flow above the plate bounded by delta, where the effects of the viscous shearing force caused by fluid viscosity are existing. As I told you here, the velocity of the, here the velocity of fluid before it reaches the surface like this, when it reaches the surface, it will be like this, or it will change. But as you notice here, the main changes is here, and in this, distance from the surface, which we measure this distance by delta, and we say that this is boundary layer, and the velocity in this boundary layer is called velocity boundary layer. This delta is boundary layer thickness. It is typically defined as the distance y from the surface at which u is equal to 0.99 v. V is the initial velocity of the fluid before it reaches to this extent, for example, from the surface. And as long as it will continue, you can see here fully developed, later you will see about this word as well, for fully developed fluid flow, the velocity here is different from the V. But as long as we go toward, far from the surface, the velocity of the fluid flow will be again going back to the V. We call this U. Here U, all of them are U in each Y, and in the Y, in this direction we have Y, in this direction, sorry about the green, this direction we have Y, this direction is X. Okay, in each Y we have U, and in one Y, in this Y, Y1 for example, U will be equal to 0.99 V. For example, if it's 10 meters per second, U in this direction, in this distance from the surface, will be 0.99 times that 10 meters per second. Then this, we say this distance from the surface as delta, and we say that before this, we have boundary layer, and after that, we don't have boundary layer. So by this, we can determine that boundary layer thickness. That hypothetical line, which I told you, the delta, which is in delta from the surface, divide the floor of a plate in two different regions. Boundary layer region, which I told you, the viscose effects and the velocity changes are significant. And then beyond that, we have the rotational flow region, which the frictional effects are negligible and the velocity remain necessarily constant. And you can see also here, however, this figure, later we will more discuss about that. But here you can see when the fluid reaches the surface, its velocity is like this. Usually its velocity will change, you know, initially the all the, you know, the we have this laminar boundary layer, it will be like this, smooth flow, then it will go to transitional region like this, and after that we will reach boundary, turbulent boundary layer like this. You know, this is dependent on the you know, direction. Later we will be more discuss about this figure actually. But generally we reach this, when we reach this X from the reference, we can find the delta or boundary layer and also the irrotational flow region.